In 1911, Gopal Krishna Gokhale presented the first bill of free and compulsory education in the Imperial Assembly. It was not passed, could not be passed, because of resistance from two sections of society. One was feudal, another was emerging bourgeoisie. From the feudal section, Raja of Darbhanga, Maharaja of Darbhanga, collected 11,000 signatures from big landlords and big Rajas and Maharajas. We said, if you ensure that all children go to school, then who will do farming in our farmlands? At least they were honest to say that if all children go to school, there'll be no one to do farming. Today's government is not honest. And the preceding governments also, because these governments do not want to acknowledge that more than half of India's children continue to be child laborers. Their names will be enrolled. Yeah, there'll be 100% enrollment. 100% enrollment was, some people wrongly say, 100% enrollment happened after Right to Education Act. No, dear, my dear friend, look at the data. 100% enrollment was there from 1990 onwards. It was always there, because enrollment is just recording the names, and all headmasters are under orders to record the name of every child in the village. So they write the names of every child in the enrollment register. But at least half of the India's children are not in schools. The other resistance came from bourgeoisie. The representative of bourgeoisie, then shifting from Kolkata to Mumbai at that time, rose in the Imperial Assembly and said, don't make haste. India is a poor country. We don't have resources. So let us not rush into trouble. In fact, I'm jumping the years. The same thing we heard in 1946-47, when Constituent Assembly was discussing what should be fundamental right in the constitution, what should not be. So there was a fundamental right committee, special committee to decide whether to accept the proposals coming from the drafting committee led by Dr. Ambedkar. So the drafting committee has proposed that education up to 14 years of age must be made compulsory and free and must be fundamental right. So it was placed in part 3 of the constitution. The Fundamental Right Committee, led by Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, addressed his Fundamental Right Committee and said, look, this proposal has come before us from the drafting committee, and it's going to be very difficult for us to decide whether to accept education as a fundamental right or not. And everything under the sun cannot be accepted, because after all, India is a poor country, we don't have resources. We must be very careful about accepting or not accepting a proposal on fundamental right. So keeping this in mind, that we are a poor country, please decide. And when Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel has spoken, then all the Rai Bahadurs and Sardar Bahadurs and Khan Bahadurs, who are members of the committee, that was the character of the Constituent Assembly at that time, none of them had courage to say that we have the resources. So it was shifted from part 3 of the constitution to part 4 of the constitution. It never became a fundamental right until 1993 Unnikrishnan judgment from Supreme Court, we declared it as a fundamental right. The interim period between Gopal Krishna Gokhale's bill and Constituent Assembly not deciding to make education a fundamental right is very important. Many things happened. After Jallianwala Bagh, Gandhiji gave a call, you know, pained by what happened in Jallianwala Bagh. He gave a call to all the young people to quit schools, colleges and universities run by the British government. He said, quit all the British government educational institutions, come out and set up national educational institution. It was a revolt against the very idea of a British educational institution, because British educational institution was enslaving the minds of our children and youth. So here Gandhi said, rebel against them, come out and set up your own educational institution. And a very lovable story is when a young person doing MA in economics quit at the call of Gandhiji, quit Aligarh Muslim University, came out and set up a two-room college and started teaching MA in economics course, until attention was caught by a Hamdard Dawakhana people in Karol Bagh in Delhi, and invited the young person to come to Hamdard Dawakhana campus and set up a college for teaching economics. And that grew along the side of freedom struggle. And when we got freedom, it became the present day Jamia Millia, you know, Islamia. And the young person was Dr. Zakir Hussain. In 1928, Bhagat Singh wrote a short article. He wrote many things, but one short article, only 2.5 pages long, called Students and Politics, Vidyarthi or Rajniti. In that article, Bhagat Singh refers to the Viceroy visiting Lahore and the school college authorities forcing the students to go and welcome Viceroy. So he writes in the article, when Viceroy comes to Lahore, we are told to attend all his events and be present there. But when Nehru comes to Lahore, or Gandhiji comes to Lahore, or Subhash Chandra Bose comes to Lahore, and we go to attend those meetings, then we are told you are doing politics. Why is attending Viceroy's meeting not a politics? Why attending Gandhi's meetings or Nehru's or Subhash Chandra Bose becomes politics? This question he raises. Then he says, we are told that your task is only to study, not to do any politics. We agree our task is to study in the college. But while we are studying, are you going to keep us away from understanding what is the economic and social conditions of our country and what is happening in our country you don't want us to understand? If you don't want us to understand, what kind of education are you imparting to us? Questions the very character of education. Then he says, such an education is not meant to educate, is meant only to turn us into clerks of the British Empire, and we are not ready to accept such an education. This is a very rich discourse taking place. And then Ambedkar, Baba Ambedkar, when in 1936 gives his slogan, educate, agitate, and organize. One has to apply mind. He's giving the slogan to the Dalit section of society, which is about 22-23% of our population. Why a Dalit has to agitate and organize in order to be educated? Is it not true today? Dalits are still fighting. To be educated, they have to fight. In order to be educated, they have to form student organization. They form Ambedkar Student Association. When they form Ambedkar Student Association on the campus of Hyderabad Central University, then they are called anti-national, casteist, and extremist, because they formed Ambedkar Student Association. And what are they asking for? They're saying, please pay our UGC scholarship in time, because we come from poor families. We cannot support our families if you do not pay us in time. Because they're asking for scholarship to be paid in fine, therefore, they are called anti-nationalists and casteists and extremists. So Ambedkar, who talked about Dalits in 1936, today Ambedkar's formula can be applied to all sections of Indian society. All have to fight to be educated. They have to agitate, they have to organize themselves. Whether they are called anti-nationalists or not, that's besides the point, they'll continue to be called. And when Kanhaiya Kumar and Rohit Vemmulu are created by the very process of what is happening in the country, then the education minister of the BJP government in Rajasthan declares, the education system which we are going to establish shall not produce Kanhaiya Kumars and Rohit Vemmulas. It's a statement with a lot of deliberate thought. And the education system now being set up, of course, a world-class institute, shall never allow you to. Never allow Kanhaiya Kumars and Rohit Vemmula even to be admitted. Forget about creating Kanhaiya Kumars and Rohit Vemmula. They'll not even be admitted. The rules and regulations have come out under UGC guidelines. In 1937, Gandhi organized an All India Conference on Education in Wardha. And while addressing the conference, he said, When I spin thread from cotton with takli, while spinning, I'm also measuring its length. While spinning, I'm also weighing it. So I'm learning how to calculate. I'm learning mathematics. I'm learning physics. And when I'm doing it, I also learn about history of exploitation by cotton mills of Lancashire. I also think about exploitation of Indian farmers by these cotton mills. And therefore, I learned history as well. And he says, I know only spinning. Therefore, I give this example, but you can choose your own trade and your own productive activity, whatever you want to choose. But connect productive tasks with curriculum. And he proposes Nayi Talim as a totally new concept, which will break the dichotomy, 5,000-year-old dichotomy between work and knowledge, 5,000-year-old. And when a tribal young person dared to challenge this dichotomy between work and knowledge called Eklavya, he had to forego his thumb. Drodacharya took away the thumb. Here was a proposal in 1937. The productive work has to be at the very center, organically at the center of the curriculum, in every classroom of independent India. Very few have tried to even understand. It was not accepted by any government from the time of independence onwards up to now. And every time somebody talked about productive caste, people said, oh, Gandhi must have meant it for poor people. Oh, Gandhi must have meant it only for villages. Oh, Gandhi must have meant it for urban slums. Oh, he doesn't mean, he never meant it for us, for our children. He meant exactly for us. Because he saw that as long as the dichotomy between productive work and knowledge is maintained in the classroom and in the society, caste system cannot go away. In order to challenge caste system, productive work has to become part of education system. It was a revolutionary proposal coming from Gandhi. Instead of developing the proposal and taking it forward and finding ways and means of concretizing the proposal in classrooms of India, it was given up forever. This is a rich history. Curriculum, financing of education, the issue of caste, class, gender, all this become part of our discourse of education. Language. And in 1938, Indian National Congress passed a resolution, three-point resolution on education. One, all education up to class 8 shall be in mother tongue. Mother tongue does not mean state-approved languages. It means mother tongue. In Madhya Pradesh, where I come from, people will think it means Hindi. No. Mother tongue in Madhya Pradesh means Malvi, Nimari, Bundelkhandi. These are the mother tongues of Madhya Pradesh. These are the real mother tongues. So they talked of mother tongue. Second, it shall be entirely free up to class 8. That was the immediate agenda. Somehow take all children up to class 8, which we have failed to do even until today. And third, it shall be based upon the Nayi Taleem conception of curriculum and pedagogy. We have failed in all three. I'll refer to 1985, where the first evidence of the attack of globalization became evident. Of course, the formal announcement of globalization was in 1991, we all know that. But its evidence was available even earlier. In 1985, the name of Education Ministry was changed to Human Resource Development Ministry. Without any debate in the parliament, without any discussion anywhere, suddenly we know one morning this name has changed. It was not a change of nomenclature, it was change of the very conception of education. A year later, 86 policy comes. 86 policy passed by the parliament with unanimous vote, not a single dissenting voice. 86 policy declared that half of India's children shall not be provided a school. Instead, they will be provided an evening non-formal center. Then the program of action of 86 passed by the parliament said, why evening center? Why not a day center for them? Evening center because these are child laborers. And when child laborers return home, they'll be very tired. So they should be given 1 or 2 hours to have food and be ready for a non-formal center under a candlelight. So that will be provided. The teachers there shall not be regular, properly trained, properly paid teachers. These are poor children, poorest section of Indian society. Therefore, they will be provided underpaid, untrained contract teachers. After 1991, India faced structural adjustment, a conditionality of structural adjustment, which was an essential condition if Indian government wants more loans from the international market. So IMF and World Bank together told Indian government, we'll give you provided you accept structural adjustment condition. What is structural adjustment? Structural adjustment condition told the Indian government that you have to now, for getting loans, you have to give a solemn promise that you shall start reducing public expenditure on education, health, all schemes of social welfare, poverty alleviation, and all such subsidized programs. If you don't, we'll stop giving you loans. We not only accepted, but we kowtowed totally. Towards the end of the decade of 90, we even made an act in the parliament to ensure that we don't cross the limits set by the IMF and World Bank, and it's called FRBM, Finance Regulation and Budget Management Act. It continues, even Finance Minister Jaitley said we agree with the, despite all the rhetoric of Rashtrapakti, they accept the diktat of World Bank and IMF that our deficit will not go beyond 3% as dictated under FRBM, which is itself a product of orders from World Bank and IMF. In 1992-93, World Bank tells us how to run your primary education. You ever imagine? India with its legacy, which I'm talking about, is being told how to run your primary schools. And they make a program. They give us a program called District Primary Education Program, which within 10 years covered half of India's district and 18 states of India. And that program was designed to destroy public-funded primary and upper primary schools. The surprising thing was that when this was happening, the teachers' union kept quiet. Because the very first step was to make teachers, all teachers, to be recruited from then onwards, make them contract teachers. Underpaid, untrained contract teachers. And when we go further in 90s, we see now even the teachers are not just going to be two kinds of teachers, contract teachers and regular teachers, but even the contract teachers will be divided into several layers. Several layers of contractualization will take place. Each layer will become weaker than it was earlier. Earlier, if all contract teachers mobilize themselves together, there'll be trouble. So divide them into Samvida Ek, Samvida Do, Samvida Teen. They all happened in Madhya Pradesh and continue to happen. So every section of contract teacher has to fight its own battle. Then comes a time when single teacher schools were promoted under Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Single teacher schools promoted under Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Never probably heard of it. Those schools were called education guarantee centers. It guaranteed everything except education. Education guarantee center started from 97, where Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan started from year 2000. But from year 2000, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan accepted the whole formulation of education guarantee centers. It said, in its very first formulation of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan approved in 10th five-year plan, it says very clearly, henceforth, will provide primary and upper primary education either through schools or through education guarantee centers or from other forms of alternative forms of schools. School is no more going to be an institution through which we'll provide education. School is meant increasingly is going to mean from 2000 on, from 90s onward, for better off sections of society, not for the poorest sections of society. Lot of euphemisms were developed. And I found out, as neoliberalism, this is a neoliberal policy framework under globalization, and neoliberalism attacks us, it chooses many new words for us, beautiful words. At that time, they talked about Shikshak Mitra. For contract teachers, it was Shiksha Mitra. In different languages, they have different names. The Bal Mitra, all kinds of names were thought of. And those teachers of the education guarantee centers, single teacher schools, in only for Dalit and tribal hamlets, not for any other section of society, only for ST children, that single teacher school, education guarantee center school, that those were called Guruji, as if rest of them are not Guruji. To give them more respect. The more respect you mean that more exploitation will take place against you. All these formulations became perfect during 90s. And then there were time had come to apply it to higher education. Now the global market learned that they can succeed to destroy elementary education of 8 years, and nobody really protests. The intellectual class is also intellectual class. Economy is structurally adjusted, but intellectual class is intellectually adjusted and not raising a voice. Otherwise, if the higher education academia had raised voice in 90s, we would not have probably seen the day which we're seeing now. So it's a self-criticism of the higher education academia also.